So I chose sort of a dreamy painting belonging to Rita Severis, who's going to come next week and talk to you about Camion Lar and the amazing acquisition she made. And I will hit the road for the Famagusta Gate. Famagusta Gate is probably the most important Renaissance building we have in Cyprus. And it's a proof of our European heritage, a proof of how the Venetians, when they came in 1489, focused on the defense of the island, destroyed the old defense, which was a French defense, and imported this new fortification system, which gives us a unique position in history of the architecture of fortified places. Just a simple map to show you how important Famagusta is, much more important than what Nicosia is. You stress the difference between the two. Nicosia, they spent thousands of money on doing a completely new fortification, which I'm sure you all know lasted out only for 4 months of siege, whereas Famagusta lasted out for 11 months for a very simple reason, that the fortifications were done on the reef. As you know, Famagusta's story is based on the history of three reefs, the one denominating the harbor, the one denominating the fortifications, and the one denominating the outer part of the harbor, the moat, right? So this construction of Henry II back in the 14th century was just strengthened in Famagusta, whereas in Nicosia, a whole new system using a new technique, the fronte bastionato, right, was used, having a completely closed fortification system. This is a wrong map, actually, because what the Venetians did was to stop the Pedieos River running through the city, and they diverted it all around. This is actually a 16th century map of Nicosia, and you had three exits: Famagusta Gate, Paphos Gate, and Perimeter Gate. Oh, that's a touch screen.
Yes.
So I think there's a lot to tell about how the Nicosia fortifications came to be, but that will take me on a whole lecture of its own. So I will fly in time, and I will take us to the British occupation in 1878. We can say a lot of bad things about the British people, but we can say definitely one good thing is that they knew what European cultural heritage was about. We Cypriots, even in that time, we were not really aware of this European cultural heritage we had. And I must say that it fitted the British very well. They ruled by using the famous word divide and rule, right? So they divided the Greek Cypriots and the Turkish Cypriots. We owe it to them. But they also did not want to restore only Turkish Cypriot monuments or Greek Cypriot monuments, right? Not Orthodox, not Islamic monuments. So they opted on restoring European cultural monuments. And we owe the fact that they did it back in the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, to three people. The one is George Jeffrey. The other one is Peter McGaw. And the third one is Rupert Gunness. Now these three people were aware of the importance of our cultural heritage. And had it not been for them, probably the generations we have today and our kids wouldn't have been able to see neither St. Hilaria, nor Rucavento, nor Gandara Castle. They did it in a different way. And I must say, last time I was in Gandara last week, I saw that the Department of Antiquities on this site is taking away the cement that was used and is doing it in a very good way. So they did it in a rather ugly manner. They restored, they used a lot of cement, a lot of concrete, and We owe them a big thanks because some of the monuments are still there thanks to this restoration. Now, when they came to Nicosia and they saw the Famagusta Gate, the old aqueduct, the Siliktar, water was brought into Nicosia by Arab Ahmed and Siliktar, right? We owe it to those Ottomans that brought the water into Nicosia by these two big aqueducts. So the Siliktar, which we uncovered, I don't know, those of you who know a bit of Nicosia, in front of the new archbishopric, you can see the aqueduct. But it also passed in front of the Famagusta Gate. This is easier then. Yeah. So here you see it passing in front, right? And the British in 1930, what they did is to uncover, you see parts of it? They uncovered the facade of the Famagusta Gate. It was a huge work, and they did it because they considered that Famagusta Gate had the importance of, as a Renaissance building, and it is a very elaborate facade. I brought a book for your library in which I found the examples of the Italian gates. I found the books by Serlio, for instance, and he mentioned that a gate has to be a very important structure because it's the first thing one sees when one enters. So we kept, thank God, they kept the Mahmud II Ottoman addition to it, like all the three gates have, right? And they uncovered both of the rooms. This is some of the old photographs the Department of Antiquity in Nicosia has. And while editing and writing this book, I used a lot of their photographic material. Now we know a lot about who did the fortifications in Nicosia. He's a person I've been sleeping with for the past 25 years of my life. He's called Giulio Savorgnano. He's an architect. He comes from Venice. He built the Lido fortifications, the Zara fortifications, the ones in Corfu, the ones in Crete. And he came to Cyprus. He didn't want to. You'll read all that in the book. He had some weird feelings about Cyprus and how he should build the fortifications. He was very angry with the people that made the additions on the Famagusta fortifications, saying that cost 10 years of time and a lot of money, whereas I want to build an entirely new system here. And this is the gate he built in Heraklion, in Crete, which resembles very much the Famagusta Gate. Unfortunately, my compatriots, the Cretans, got rid of it. So this is one and only image we have of what the fortifications of Heraklion looked like. And then we had to go into the research to find more about it. Because coming back from my studies in Belgium, being a young archaeologist and art historian, I had come back to Cyprus after 1974, and I was immediately employed by the municipality of Nicosia. I want to make this parenthesis because it's important. The municipality of Nicosia was run then, the mayor then, was a very special character, a very gifted man and a real Cypriot. He's called Lelos Dimitriades. And in the years of 1982, we had the possibility, through his relation to the then mayor of Nicosia, who was Mustafa Akinci, to start building trust between, first of all, the two mayors, and then the employees that were within it. So we set off to restore the Famagusta Gate, because the area around the Famagusta Gate was a very important area of Nicosia, where the rich houses were, where the people that had a lot of money made beautiful houses there. But as of 1958, spanning all the way down to 63, when the first intercommunal problems started, and of course with 1974, the area was entirely abandoned. Abandoned because of the fear of the war, And those places were either rented out and they became workshops. So we saw our cultural heritage sort of changing hands and being used for workshops and places that were really not fit for that. So being full of energy at that time and enthusiasm for the city, we went on a project to restore the Famagusta Gate to its former glory. I'm not very proud to say that our Department of Antiquities used the Famagusta Gate as a place, a sort of workshop as well. Nobody looked at it as the principal gate and a real presence of the Renaissance in La Città Ideale and all these phenomena that brought the Renaissance into Cyprus. So we looked into publications, into gravures, into etchings, to find out more about it. And basically it was the British period that gave us a lot of information. This is what the gate looked like when we asked for it. The municipality of Nicosia asked the Department of Antiquities to hand over the Famagusta Gate. And of course they said no. No way, no way. So the mayor of Nicosia then said, I'll publish these. Because these are how you use it, and this is not how the Famagusta Gate should be used. So after threatening and having a real war between us, we managed to get it. These are some other very shameful photographs. I'm not very proud of showing them, but it's to make the difference of what will come later on. And we became a working team. So Lelos Dimitriadis was heading the team. We had archaeologists, we had the municipal engineer, we had the architect from the public works department, because, let me make another little parenthesis, our Department of Archaeology, of Antiquities, depends from the Ministry of Roads and Communications. This is what it was like back in the British times, because monuments were found while the English were digging up to make the roads, right? But there's really no justification for the Department of Antiquities to be today under that, because the budget goes to the marinas and the airports and the roads, and the budget allocated to the Department of Antiquities is always very little. So we hit the road with three architects in Nicosia. We found items that were very important. But basically, we had a good time. I don't know if some of you met Agni Petridou, who is now heading, she's the municipal engineer of the Department of Antiquities. This is Lelos Dimitriadis, this is the guy, this is me when I was young. And these are the two architects that worked with us. And first of all, we found a building which was at the lowest part of the city, through which the Pedieos River ran through. In the old times, it was called Taht el Kale, meaning the old castle, right? So we had a huge issue of water and dampness of the whole building. So what we did was first to dig on both sides of the building and insulate the building from the structures right next to it. That cost a lot of money. So at the beginning, the mayor said, we'll need to come out with a campaign. And we came out with a campaign to the people of Nicosia. And it's the people of Nicosia that gave us the money to restore the Famagusta Gate. At that time, UNDP wasn't that. This came a year after we restored the gate. This was an amazing example of how we insulated the gate. Again, through all these amazing lunches and dinners we all had together, we discussed on a friendly basis of how things should happen. And we faced the problem of humidity and dampness through ICOMOS and ICROM in Rome. So we asked a specialist to come to give us instructions of how we should handle a building which is made out of sandstone. You know how porous sandstone is, especially after all these centuries of water going through, being the lowest part of the city. So he indicated to us to do the cleaning of the stone with water at first, And then to apply, at that time, we're talking of 1982, so it was a very different time of the technology that one would have today. We use a special material called Paraloid B72, and we cover all the masonry, and this is a special product that leaves the stone to breathe, or else if the water would have stayed in, the masonry would have cracked. So this was a huge work to undertake, and we did it. The gate during the British time was whitewashed at some areas as well to prevent the stone from coming down. I don't know why they did it. We tried to get rid of the painting with wet sandblasting. This is what ICROM told us at that time. So we spent a lot of time trying to separate the gate from the issues of humidity. Next surprise. We were allowed in. So what do we find as a basis and as a floor? Tombstones. Like, of course, all the major Renaissance buildings. When restorations were done in St. Nicholas in Famagusta or in Hagia Sophia in Nicosia, at the major building, the floor used was tombstones that were put on the other side. So much to our surprise, when we lifted those stones, we found the names, we found inscriptions, and this was an amazing sort of discovery for all of us. We studied them and we sent them off to the medieval museum we have in Limassol. We'll ask them back, because if there's a new museum, hopefully to be built in the years to come, the old museum we have in Nicosia will be a medieval museum. So we'll get them back from us sometime. So this was quite a work to do. You see some of the stones we had inscriptions and portraits. And there was an issue there, what to put as a floor. We discussed over lots and lots of lunches, I will not show you the pictures, and lots of dinners. We argued a lot of what the floor should be like, because we thought that Famagusta Gate, we decided, not we, the municipal commission decided to turn it into a cultural center. And to turn this into a cultural center, you need to heat it in the winter and cool it in the summer, right? So we had to put ducts first, and to see what the floor would be like, and how we didn't want to have air conditionings to be apparent, right? So we wanted all these systems to be under flooring. So we decided to use, well, these are some cannonballs we found. We found a lot of little items. We didn't find any particular important item. It's a bit out of focus. We worked and found the coat of arms of all the people that gave money so that the gate would be built. Because, as usual, Venetians ran out of money. They asked the Council of Ten. The Council of Ten wouldn't give them money. So a lot of Venetian families and the Greek families that were living in Nicosia gave money. This is why the shields and the coat of arms of these people are on the outside of the gate. Just to show you some pictures of the insulation that continued all through. We really made a huge separation between the earth here, insulated, put special material that was brought in from ICROM to stop the water from coming in. And of course, we diverted not the river, because the river since Ottoman times never really touched the gate, but there were parallel riverbeds that were ending up in the Famagusta Gate as well. So this was one of the most costly restorations work we did. And coming back to what I was telling you, we decided to put the ducts and the electricity and the powers and all underneath, and we decided finally to use terracotta made in Cyprus in a place outside Nicosia called Agios Theodoros. So it's really Cypriot material put in, and it really gave it a lovely look. I don't know if you've been there, but it's already, there's patina on it, and it looks like as if it was there since the beginning. And then we had to deal with issues from the outside. Famagusta Gate, guards the entrance from the areas of Kaimakli and Panuriotissa. And these areas, of course, also from Famagusta, this is why it carries its name as well. So we had major issues as well on the problems we had in facing the restructuring of the walls of Nicosia. And I'm sure you all know that the walls of Nicosia were rubble and were covered with wheat and earth. Because we found the diaries of Giulio Savorgnano, and he said that during times of peace, we cover the rubble with mud brick. Mud brick is the word I was looking for. And it's the Turkish people, when they came after 1570, that brought specialists to put the stones on the wall. So what the Venetians did was to carry the rubble from the destruction of the outer French fortification, and they didn't have time. The fortification of Nicosia started in 1567, and by 1570, we had the Ottoman attack, right? Mm-hmm. So there was not much time to prepare it. So what the Ottomans faced, and actually it was good, because when the cannoning came, when the cannon fell in the earth, of course it doesn't make any further destruction, right? So what we uncovered was the old wall, which was earth and rubble. So when we uncovered places like that, we found pieces of the French fortification, right? So we put them away. So all this was amazing history for all of us. Today, we could, with GIS, find where the old fortification was, and it was much larger than the tighter fortification the Venetians did. So we looked at all these problems on a daily basis and started working on the outside. And this is, we diverted any water coming into the gate. We closed it and made a very nice entrance to the gate. You see the old Ottoman gate that was still there. Famagusta Gate was a passage, a real passage, just like Carinya Gate is and Paphos Gate is. And the walls were on the gate. So we know through what Giulio Savorgnano left to us in his diary, but we also know from the people that came and left us voyages and trips and descriptions that gates opened at sunrise and closed at sunset. It's the British that made the openings of Nicosia, because the British worked within. They destroyed in 1904 the Sarajevo, right? The palace of the Venetians. And they worked within, but they lived on the outskirts of Nicosia. So to ease circulation between them, they made the major openings. So in all three gates, you have the wall not joining the gate, but there's a passage between. So we had to work on that as well to see how we would fix that. We got these people to make this pebbled entrance to the monument. This is what it looks like all the way till today. And then, as we thought, we'd turn this into a cultural center. We made a little theater, which we pulled down during the winter months and put up during the festival of Nicosia, right? And at the back, we did a park, a sculptural park. Nothing much remains of that today, I must say. I'm very cross. And this has been turned into a dog park right now. A lot of the works of art were destroyed. We had a brilliant time when De los Ministeriales was a mayor for 30 consecutive years. The mayors that followed had not the will, nor the enthusiasm, nor the knowledge. Instead of that, they accepted this disastrous project of Zaha Hadid, I don't know how you, whether you've seen it, where people will be laughing at us because we had a beautiful monument of the 16th century. And now, with the construction of this amazing concrete passage, you will not be able to understand the symmetry between the bastions, because they are a beautiful symmetry that refers to the ideal city. And what was important at that time was symmetry, classical beauty. These things now will fade away because of this concrete platform that will change even the climate of Nicosia. So we did constructions that we would pull down eventually when we didn't need them. The Ottoman beautiful door of the main entrance. So Famagusta Gate is made out of the main passage, that it has an amazing character of fortified architecture because it's very narrow in the entrance, then it becomes wider, and then it's narrow again. So anybody coming in is controlled, the amount of people come in. And of course, from the top of the Famagusta Gate, like they did in the old times, they poured hot oil or hot water, whatever, in that time. And this is the ceremony of the opening, which was a very touching ceremony, very simple ceremony. That's Lelos Dimitriadis addressing the people, inviting the people who gave money for the restoration of the Famagusta Gate. And ever since, and due to the presence of the Famagusta Gate, that part of Nicosia, Agios Cassianos and Chrysalignonissa, became center points, trendy places. What followed the Famagusta Gate is a landmark, because that's the beginning of the Nicosia Master Plan. And the Nicosia Master Plan is what changed the future of Nicosia, and what I hope will change the future of Nicosia. We're talking of harsh times, right? It's the time when Akinji was mayor of Nicosia and Lelos was. We had Spiros Kyprianou on the one side and you had Raoul Bektash. So as to meet, it was an amazing thing. So we went to the Lidro Palace, had our trousers checked on behalf of the UN. And at the beginning it was very, we were all not at ease because we talked about issues that had nothing to do with what the real issue was about. So we talked about Dubrovnik and we talked about Zara and we talked about all these places that needed, we talked about Berlin, right? And then slowly, 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 we started facing our own problems. And like Akinji and Lelos Dimitriadis said, Nicosia one day, inshallah, is going to be a free city like the whole of Cyprus should be, right? And we should know how construction goes on one side, and you should know how construction. So we made, this is the basis for the Nicosia Master Plan. So what happened then? When the Nicosia Master Plan was agreed, and that was an agreement that followed a necessity, because we had to do a new sewage plant, right? And the plant was in what today is the occupied area of Nicosia. So these guys had to work together. And there was no media, there was no television, there was no motherlands, there was nothing. They sat on a dinner table, had kebab, and decided on the future of Nicosia. And it really worked, because these two people trusted each other. When Lelos said something, Akinji would trust him. When Akinji said something. So he came very often to Nicosia at all our exhibitions. We traveled because we as Greek Cypriots didn't enter since 1963. And as my daughters say, I'm Paleolithic, so in 1963 I was a big girl, right? And we walked Nicosia, and this is when UNDP walked in. United Nations Development Plan gave money to Cyprus, and we selected the areas that needed to be restored. When we worked on Agios Cassianos, you worked on Arab Ahmet. When we worked on Chrysalignonissa, you worked on Samanbakhchi. And there was a real cooperation between the architects of the two municipalities, but there was more than that, there was friendship. So it crossed the borders of what we had to do. That's why this was a very happy moment for Nicosia. He came over, saw one of the most magnificent exhibitions we had. This is Melina Mercuri, right? Mrs. Kiprianou, Lellos once more. We had magnificent exhibitions staged, and this became a focal point of Nicosia. People gathered every night because people came, because we got over the fear problem, and people started restoring their houses. People started going back to their houses. People asked for loans to restore their houses. UNDP and the municipality offered low rate loans. And Nicosia acquired a new form. This is one of the beautiful exhibitions we had by an artist called a Greek artist, Alithinos. And you see the pavement, and you see how beautiful the gate looked. And of course, we received in 1984 a Europa Nostra Prize. We're all very proud to have been awarded. And the Famagusta Gate is again today a place where you have fashion shows, where you have events, where you hold concerts, where we have the outer space when the theater is not there for exhibitions. We worked on the lighting system, we worked on how to hang paintings, and we're not very happy still. This interior design has to be looked upon because whatever you put against this amazing wall is lost. The wall is much more important and much more beautiful. So unless it's big, and unless the way we put it, probably we have to put white walls and leave the sandstone behind so that the work of art comes out. It's still something we have to look into. But it is a major landmark that changed the outline of Nicosia. So this is the one example I wanted to talk to you about. The next one is a Boubekir baths. Boubekir baths are hammams in the very center of Paphos, Khtima, right? These were completely abandoned. A huge parking plot was made there. They were under a terrible condition. And one of the mayors asked myself and an architect friend of mine, El Nico Sandinidu, to undertake the project. We both stressed the idea that we had to make them a hammam again, like the Buyuk hammam in Nicosia functions, or the Omeria hammam really functions into a place where people can go and have a spa, because spa are very fashionable today, so we thought that foreigners would appreciate, and Greek speakers would also appreciate a Turkish bath in the old area. Sorry. We didn't have much money there. This is why we didn't make a publication on how we restored the baths. But I'm going to show you the end results to start, and then to show you what the place looked like. So we worked on the building. We worked on, of course, according to the decision of the municipality of Paphos, they refused to turn it into a hammam. So we had to go into the same process of insulating the whole area, being the dampest place and the lowest place of Paphos again, and collecting all the waters over there. So we had huge issues of insulation, and we carried out the same system again. We brought people from Ikrom to help us. We used on the top, how do you call that in English? Khorasan,
Khorasan.
Khorasan is a Turkish
word. Khorasan, yeah.
Right? So we used exactly the same material to insulate them and to restore the glass walls of the hammam. And we restored the whole area around it so that people could see it from afar. And we even made a passage with beautiful, huge, laminated posters, big ones, showing the history of Paphos. So somebody would be attracted, and the last thing to see would be the Ebu Bekir. This is what they looked like. Being the dampest place in the whole of Paphos, full of vegetation, the amount of snakes we found when we started working there was really very unpleasant situation. This is what the baths looked like. And of course, we proceeded into making the restoration through a huge research again. And I owe a huge thanks to a Turkish Cypriot archaeologist, Tuncer Bayşan, who helped me find in Efkaf all the documents about who Ebubekir was, what he gave to Paphos, and really through that we found out when the baths were made, immediately after the conquest, so 1573, the baths are already made. And the big question was, were the baths built from scratch, or were the baths a transformation like we know that most of the buildings of the baths, like Keltikli Hamam or Kizil Hamam or the Hamams in Nicosia, were made after Gothic buildings? Because we know that when the Ottomans conquered Cyprus in 1570 and 71, it wasn't the Orthodox places that were turned into mosques. It was the Gothic, the places belonging to the Latins. Because at that time, the main enemy of the Sultan was, of course, the Pope, right? So a lot of the Gothic structures turned into mosques, mainly, and hammams as well. So, thanks to the research done by Tuncer, we found a lot of documentation, and we proposed to the municipality of Paphos to turn the baths into a museum for the history of the Turkish baths in Cyprus, which they accepted. We found a collection of bokshales, because this is something I collected since my childhood, and I gave this collection to the bath. So we had beautiful items, and we started slowly. You see all the glass heads were all gone, everything was gone, Khorasan was all gone, full of humidity. We did work all over again. And this is the passage we made where we decorated this wall with the history of Paphos. So somebody, this is the main marketplace, right? So it's a really, it really stands out today. You see, you want to see and follow the history of Paphos, and it ends up at the hammam. And these are the documents, of course, that were put up, found from the Efkaf, knowing when it functioned, the days the women were there, the days and the hours the men were there, who gave the money, how they acquired the money. All this was translated by Tuncer and put up in the hammam. And this, of course, is its basic layout. It's a full hammam, and what we knew is that this must have been a Gothic place, because there must have been, we saw the beginning of the arches outside of the hammam. But the transformation was amazing. Let me start from the back, where you have the furnace, right? And the installation there of the water tank is very important, because they needed water to heat the water so that the hammam would work. And we found all that in a very good condition. And this was the first area, the restroom, where people leave their clothes. There's usually a beautiful fountain in the middle. We saw the structure of the fountain in the middle. On this corner, there's a beautiful wall painting, very simple one. So we restructured these. These were, we used this area as restrooms, as a WC here for the people that visit the hammam. And you enter by this place, which we turned into an onda. You know, we made lovely red cushions around. And these were the tepidariums, so the two rooms where the temperature is a bit higher, right? So that your body gets accustomed to the caldarium area, which is a very hot area, and where you can have your massage and everything. And these were auxiliary rooms of somebody who wanted to have a private, we call them halvet, no? And in the halvet you had people that wanted to have private hammams. They could do that. So basically this was the layout that came. This was how we received the baths. You see, humidity was everywhere. There was this wonderful color it was pinkish, which we thought that we wouldn't use everywhere. We made the openings where the old openings were made. You see dampness all over the place. This is the sitting places people used to sit for their sweating. And these were the ducts underneath. It was before we cleaned the wall. We put the ducts with lights underneath so you can see how the pipes brought steam to the hammam. And of course the state that was in with all the birds coming in. You see, this is the first room. This was the center where the little fountain was. Well, this beautiful pinkish color we reused again. This is one painting by a French person indicating a church right next to it. And this is a wall painting we found on the Ondat room, the first room, which we restored and put it nice and back. And this was the ceremony that was made the day the hammam was opened by the municipality of Paphos, with everything beautifully cleaned out and lit from underneath, with all the bokshades on and leaflets for everybody to understand what it was to be, how one would spend a day in a hammam. There was a little leaflet showing what the process of a hammam is like. This is the little ondah we made so that people would sit around. Of material and of the colors we had found. These are all the bokshades that were put in plexiglass so that they would be free from, because humidity is there. I mean, it's under the whole building, so the only way to keep humidity out is to open the building right now and to leave it in the sun. But of course, they were scared of the destruction. This is what the hammam looks like today. There's a little cafe here that was made, and this was the invitation of the exhibition on the history of Paphos. It was called Faces of Paphos, right on the way, all the way down, and a day in the Turkish bath, and the transcript in English. Thank you very much.